Greetings, Fright Nights. I'm Count Jackula.
I'm the Horror Guru.
And we just saw The Hateful Eight.
It was fucking awesome.
Yeah.
We're gonna start with the spoiler-free portion, because there's a lot in this movie to spoil, so...
Yeah. Can't really get into the real meat of the plot without getting into spoilers.
So we're gonna just spoiler-free. If you like Tarantino, fucking... see this movie. If you're already a Tarantino fan, you probably have already seen it, but if you haven't, definitely see it. And if you can, go see the 70mm version of it, because it is a fantastic experience.
Yeah, absolutely. You go to the 70mm version, you get to see the extended cut, you get an intermission at the hour and a half mark, and they give you this.
Absolutely.
You know, it was absolutely beautiful. I had one of these when I was a kid for like Raiders of the Lost Ark and absolutely Return of the Jedi.
Absolutely.
You know, I wish I still had them.
Almost definitely.
But those things fell apart.
Done. If you're a fan of Sam Jackson and Kurt Russell, they are fantastic in this movie. So definitely see it to see their performances, if nothing else.
Absolutely.
There's other people who have great performances too. Like Tim Roth was one of my favorite characters in the movie.
God. Yeah.
As the English hangman.
Yeah.
Who was fucking fun as hell. There's plenty of, like, there's some characters that actors we can't even talk about without spoiling, so.
Yeah. The movie, in a nutshell, is essentially Reservoir Dogs and Django Unchained kind of combined into one movie.
Yeah. With, like, the atmosphere of, like, The Thing.
Yeah. The atmosphere is very reminiscent of The Thing. There's a bunch of guys snowed in that can't leave.
Mm-hmm. And a whole lot of paranoia about who did what, who killed who, what's going on.
Yeah, which is why Tarantino cast Kurt Russell as...
Yes, which is very, very obvious that was part of the idea. And
yeah,
the music, there's the original score by Ennio Morricone, but there's also some of his other scores, namely the one from The Thing that's actually used in the movie, so you can tell it's actually deliberate how...
Yeah. You don't have Morricone make an original score and then use part of his old score.
Yeah.
You know, unless you mean that you're like, no, it's not getting any better than this.
So basically you have a movie that combines like the Ennio Morricone movies that were essentially, you know, Westerns combined with the stuff he did, like The Thing, into one movie.
Yeah.
And he's just a composer, but like you could see that Tarantino on some level put those two things together because of the same composer and stuff like that.
Yeah. And the thing I like about this is much more than even his previous two movies, that being Django Unchained and Inglourious Basterds.
Mm-hmm.
This movie is mean.
Oh, gee. Yeah.
This movie is mean as
shit. The other obvious inspiration for this movie is Sam Peckinpah movies.
Oh, yeah.
And the thing about Sam Peckinpah movies is there's rarely ever heroes in his stories. They're almost all like terrible people who do terrible things that are humanized to the point where you might care about them anyway.
Yeah.
But like his movies are usually about really awful people, like The Wild Bunch.
Yeah, Wild Bunch.
Is a very obvious inspiration for this movie. A very super violent Western.
As far as I can tell, The Wild Bunch is the first time a Gatling gun is used in a Western.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah.
I would not be surprised if that's the case. If not, feel free to correct us below if we got any Western experts up
there.
Yeah.
Western is not... I like Westerns, but they are not my forte.
I love them, but I'm not an expert in them in the slightest, you know?
Yeah, not like horror movies.
Oh, not like horror movies, you know? Like, the kind of Westerns I tend to like tend to come from the 70s, and...
Yeah.
Before that, I'm not very knowledgeable. I don't know much about John Wayne movies outside of key important ones, like who shot Liberty Valance or things like that.
Yeah.
My Western knowledge is far more limited. So if there was a Gatling gun used in a different movie, feel free to correct us. We love to hear these things.
Yeah, absolutely.
But like this movie, like it's interesting because there's a lot of people who said this movie was more violent than any other Tarantino movie.
I really disagree with that.
It is not. Kill Bill and Django alone, those two alone, are more violent than this movie. I think the real difference is, without getting into spoilers, is the violence in this movie is treated more like a horror movie.
Yeah, every time, like, you know, every time the proverbial axe falls, you feel it, because they've just built up this huge amount of tension.
Yeah.
And because of the way it's shot, like, these effects are done by Greg Nicotero.
Yes, yes.
Of Can Be and John Dykstra.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was like, wait, John Dykstra came back?
Apparently, like, he had some sort of connection with the actual, like, digital effects in the movie. So,
oh, man. Yeah.
Which is pretty awesome. And in the credits, they're like the second billing, so you know how important they were to the movie.
Yeah.
And they fucking are. They fucking are.
Yeah.
Because this movie is violent, don't get me wrong. But the difference between this and, like, Django and Kill Bill, which I would argue are more violent than this, is that those are action movies, you know? So the violence in them are more thrilling and exciting, and you're watching bad guys getting their, like, faces blown off or their arms chopped off in blood spray, and it's awesome. Yeah. But in this movie, even though they're all awful people, you're kind of on the edge of your seat the entire time. And so when something violent does happen, it's sudden, it's explosive, and it's... And yeah. Even though these are all awful people, you start to care for a lot of them.
Yeah, yeah, you do. And one of the things I really love is that Tarantino will use your knowledge of his films against you.
He will.
And he absolutely does that here. There are a lot of shots where you're like, oh God, this is the moment. This is the moment where this guy gets his head blown off.
Yeah, yeah.
And then that doesn't happen, but something else does.
Yeah, and then the moment where a character's head will blow off is not necessarily when you expect
yeah,
it to happen.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
You know, so he's kind of fucking with his audience in the best way possible. And, Jesus, like, oh man, like, it's beautiful. Like, even though it contains story in a single location, and I've heard people compare it to, like, being, like, a stage play. It is.
It is, yeah.
It could easily be a stage play, but, like, the movie is shot so cinematically, like
yeah.
That the wide frame they use because of the 70 millimeter is used to its best effect in this movie, even though it is set in this small location to where they'll have something like a hint or something in the background that you might notice, you might not notice while you're focusing on this other thing. And there's a lot of sleight of hand going on.
Yeah, I love the opening shot. The opening shot is of a crucifix.
Mm-hmm.
It's covered in snow, and there's a crudely carved Jesus on
yes.
it. And it's what I love a about slow that. Pull out.
Yeah.
And then pan left yeah. just enough so that as the camera pans, the stagecoach way in the background
yeah.
becomes visible.
And it's not a wasted shot because it's essentially the title sequence.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, all the titles are happening while this is happening, and it's setting the mood and the atmosphere of everything that's going to go on. You know, crucifixion, like, it was a pretty apt metaphor yeah. for some things that go on yeah. here. But, like, what I also like about that shot is the way it opens up so tight and close on Jesus' face that it almost just looks like bark on a tree.
Yeah.
So you're not quite sure what it is at first, and as it pulls away, oh, it's a face. Oh, is it, like, a face on a tree? And as it pulls back, you're like, oh, no, wait, that's a hand on, oh, he's crucified. Oh, it's Jesus. And
yeah.
And that kind of is a great metaphor for the movie, that it starts off like this and slowly pulls back until you get the full picture as the yeah. movie goes on. Like, that one shot is a perfect metaphor for the whole movie. And you're glued to the screen the entire fucking time. You know, when we watched the 70 millimeter roadshow version, so we saw the longer cut with the intermission in the middle.
Absolutely.
And when the intermission started, we were actually shocked that it had already been an hour and a half, because we were so fucking, like, enthralled in the movie that it didn't feel like that much time had passed.
Yeah, it really didn't. And when we were out, the guys were like, all right, intermission's 10 minutes. Just to let you know, intermission's 10 minutes.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and then when we came back in the second half of the movie, same thing. It, like, gets to the end and we're like, oh shit, it's ending already?
Yeah, yeah.
Wait, it has been 3 hours. Holy shit, like, it's...
yeah, yeah. Well, that's how tense the movie is.
Yeah.
It's really tense.
So, like, if you're worried about it being, like, too long, we saw the one with the intermission, so we can't speak for the shorter cut that it doesn't have the intermission, but it didn't feel long to us.
No, not at all.
You know?
Not at all. The choice of how they lit that stage, that set was amazing.
Oh, man, I love the small moments where it's just like, okay, we're just gonna have this, like, single shaft golden light on this table. We're not gonna know the significance of why the table's being lit up like this until way later.
Yeah, 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 yeah. things that are lit, you're like, why are they lighting that?
Exactly.
And it becomes extremely significant.
You know, you gotta know that table's there. There's something important about that table. You don't know yet why, but it will come. You know?
Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot of small things like that throughout the movie, you know, okay, I think we're going to have to reach the point where we're going to have to start talking about spoilers, so let's just say spoiler-free, see The Hateful Eight, it's fucking awesome, it's ultra fucking violent, so if you're into that kind of movie like we are, this is a must-see. It is 3 hours, but like we said, we didn't think it felt that long.
It doesn't.
And if you see the intermission one, bonus, you can pee in the middle. Like, it's, so it's not gonna be a problem. So, yeah, spoilers.
Okay.
Holy shit.
Holy shit. All right. First thing you gotta know, which you could probably figure out, motherfucker's gonna die.
Oh, yeah.
Holy shit, motherfucker's gonna die.
You've got a cast of characters. Damn. Let's see what we got here. We've got,
we got Sam Jackson.
We got Sam Jackson, who is a bounty hunter, former, black soldier in, for the Yankee side in the Civil War.
Yeah.
You
have Kurt Russell, who is
a bounty hunter.
Bounty hunter known as the Hangman.
Yeah, he is known for, if he catches you, even if it says dead or alive on the poster, he always takes you alive to the Hangman. It's just, like, it's important to him. It's his policy. And, like, if you ask him why, he will jokingly say, like, well, the Hangman's got to make a penny, too, or something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but it's obvious it's important to him that, like, true justice is the Hangman. It isn't a bullet to the head. Like, it's,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, it's very vital. You have the crazy woman that the murderer that he's taken in that we don't know much about for most of the movie.
Yeah, yeah, we can tell she's bad.
Yeah,
because of what she does.
We can tell she's crazy. We can tell she's super racist. We don't know exactly what she did, but we know she killed somebody at some point. And that's why she's going to come in. And that's one of those things where you got to pay attention because when the reveals happen, you're going to realize, oh, they were hinting at these things.
Yeah, like, yeah, yeah. Oh, and probably biggest spoiler of all, the title is a trick.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it is.
Title's a trick.
It is a trick. It is a trick. There isn't actually just eight. There is
surprises. There is surprises.
We got fucking Tim Roth as the Englishman who claims to be a hangman.
He claims to be a hangman for the county.
But as we learn...
The actual one.
As we learn as this movie goes on, not everyone is who they claim to be.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone, almost everyone in this story
is lying.
Is a liar.
They're lying about something. Actually, does Kurt Russell lie about
Kurt Russell's the only one who doesn't lie.
I think Kurt Russell like is completely honest the whole time. That's why he's so hurt whenever he finds out that someone lied to him. Well, I guess the stagecoach doesn't lie. There's another guy.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
Whose name is, what was his name? Like,
Obi.
Yeah. Obi, the stagecoach driver, is one of the eight. He's the most, like, probably the least important.
He's the least hateful and, yeah. You know.
I don't think he ever really did anything bad.
He's got, like, how to put it? He's got body count written all over it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, you know, from the word go.
There's Obi, who's the stagecoach driver who brings Kurt Russell, the crazy girl, and Sam Jackson. And another character who claims to be a sheriff, or at least he's going to be a sheriff, and he's going to the town to become a sheriff. But in the past, apparently, they recognize him. He was the son of a Civil War general who was on the Confederate side.
Yeah.
And his general, his dad was known for just fucking hating and just raising like black villages.
Yeah.
And shit like that. So
yeah, just murdering tons of black people in the Civil War.
Super fucking racist.
Oh yeah. By the way, you're going to hear the word nigger a lot. Get used to it. Cause
duh. It is a Western. It is set right after the Civil War, at least a couple years after the Civil War.
Obviously less than 10 years after Civil War.
You know, it features characters who were in the war on both sides of the fence, and it features very prominently, the closest thing we have to a protagonist in this movie is Sam Jackson, who is a black man.
Yeah.
Surprise, he's a black man. So naturally, he faces racism in the movie. That's not the only thing you see. Kurt Russell, despite being a very, very charming and very engaging and very effective bounty hunter, is kind of a misogynist.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's fucking like he
beats the shit out of this.
And he can tell it's not just because she's a murderer. Like
he
has no qualms beating women, and that much is obvious. You know, as we learn, Sam Jackson isn't much of an angel either.
Oh no.
You know, like,
oh no.
Like in the war, he would often even, he apparently at some point, like escaped a jail and by burning it down. But like in that journey, he didn't just kill Confederates.
Yeah.
He killed other prisoners, which include, like, soldiers on the Yankee side. And so, like, he's not much of an angel either. Plus, he's also a bounty hunter, so he kills people. And he's not like the hangman. He doesn't believe in the justice. He just shoots
people. Yeah. Well, when we first meet Sam Jackson,
he's got three bodies.
He's sitting on a pile of three bodies on top of a saddle that he's just sitting there waiting, hoping someone will come by.
Absolutely. And he's got this letter from Lincoln.
Which
is my favorite plot device in the movie, is that letter of Lincoln. And I love the commentary about that, you know. Which I'm almost hesitant of whether or not I want to spoil that part, even though we're in the spoilers.
I don't know either. Let's move on. If it comes up.
Let's move on. We've got inside the house is also an old man who we learned was also a general for the Confederate side.
Yeah.
Who may or may not have a history with Sam Jackson, because they fought on in the same battle, the Battle of the Bulge, which I'm not entirely sure if that timeline works, because I don't think black soldiers were fighting in the Battle of the Bulge.
Whatever.
Who fuck cares? It's movie. Tarantino made a movie where Hitler dies. I think we can.
Yeah, we're taking some liberties here.
But Sam Jackson was on the other side, on the Yankee side during the Battle of the Bulge, and he was on one side. So they have a history with one another that we learn more of as the movie goes on.
Yeah, and this thing happens where the general pisses Sam Jackson off because, despite the fact that Sam Jackson's been like catching shade the entire movie, like, you're like, okay, this old general guy is going way farther than anybody else.
Oh god, like he's the racist. Yeah, and there's a lot of racism in this movie, and he is the most racist.
You know, and you know, Kurt Russell's like, you can't fucking kill him in cold blood.
Yeah.
You can't fucking kill him in cold blood.
Which leads to one of the best scenes in the whole
movie. Oh my god. Now, that one I gotta talk about.
Go ahead, talk about it. It is the best scene in the movie.
So, basically, Sam Jackson starts being real nice to the general after an initial friction. And starts asking about his family and, you know, why he's in Wyoming, which is where the movie's set. And then, all of a sudden, after he's got the guy good and comfortable, he disarms himself, puts his gun within reach of the general. And then tells him a story about how he knows who he is because he knows his son. Because his son came to collect a bounty that was on Sam Jackson's
Which is something
head.
Set up earlier in the movie.
Yeah.
They explained that there was a bounty on his head and that often people would go after him. But a lot of black guys were killed that weren't him because they thought it was him. But the other ones just disappeared. And Sam Jackson's, it's because they actually found me. So they were never seen again.
Yeah.
You know, and so when this guy starts talking about his son, like separately before Sam Jackson walks in, about how his son came to Wyoming for a fortune and then disappeared. And you're like, oh, I wonder if he's.
Yeah. So Sam Jackson tells him a story. Now, we're not in. We think it's a true story.
The movie. The movie leaves it open to where it could be true.
Yeah,
it could not be true. Like,
either
way, it works because Sam Jackson, as it's been established, is not being entirely truthful with things. He's actually a really great liar to get the things he wants. That is part of his character. So, like, and the funny part is, it doesn't really matter if it's true.
It doesn't. He tells him this story about how his son found him, and then he lets him live because he realizes whose son it is.
Yeah.
But so he doesn't kill him right away. But what he makes him do is he makes him take all his clothes off, walk for 2 hours in the driving snow until he collapses, and the guy is begging him for a blanket, and Sam Jackson's like, "I'll give you a blanket if you suck my cock."
Yeah.
And he forces this kid to suck his cock. And then at the end of the story, he's like, "You want to know what the funny thing is? Even after he did everything I said, I still didn't give him a blanket." The fucking general reaches for the gun, fires in his direction, and then Sam Jackson just shoots him in the head.
Yeah. Basically, the whole thing being a ploy to get him to shoot first. Because of this, there's supposedly a sheriff among them, so with everyone's witnesses that it was self-defense. Like,
yeah, exactly. And that's where the intermission happens, right after that.
Fucking great, because that is just the tip of the iceberg of how fucking intense and graphic this movie gets.
Like, yeah.
You know,
man, like, I'm like, I don't think I've ever seen a fucking, like, mouth-raping scene in a Western-style movie before.
I've never
this seen... might be a first.
This is one of the first times... I can't think of a movie where a guy openly admits to getting his dick sucked as a way to, like...
Yeah.
As a way to get at someone else.
Yeah.
You know, that was another thing I kind of liked about that. That was a twist that I'm like, oh man, I've never actually seen a scene like this before. Like, I've seen scenes where people, like, try to get other people to attack them first, but I've never seen something quite like this. It was...
Yeah. Just push every button you can.
Yeah, it was fucking... It was masterful. That was Tarantino at his, like... Tarantino is a master of tension in a way that I don't think he gets enough credit for.
No.
And this movie, if nothing else, this movie is probably the first since Inglourious Basterds that demonstrated that so well.
Yeah. And it's really weird. Like, this movie doesn't have, like, any one twist, but there are a lot of twists that happen in the course of the story.
And some of them aren't really twists so much as just developments in the plot. You know, like there are questions you're asking as the movie goes on, and then they reveal something more about it, and then, like, oh, okay. But, like, not all of them are really, like, it's not like a Shyamalan movie.
No.
But there's definitely, like, plot turns. Which I guess is a better way to put it. There's plot turns more than plot twists. You know, because you kind of know going in that a lot of these people are probably not very faithful because everyone's skeptical about them.
Yeah.
You know, so you know that people are lying, you know?
Yeah, and... Oh, God. Fucking that coffee pot.
Oh, man. God.
Okay, so this is another major spoiler. In the first half of the movie, they're constantly calling attention to this coffee pot. This is one of the items that were, like, it's mysteriously well lit. Mm-hmm. And you're like, we're supposed to see that.
And a new
coffee. Why are we supposed to see that?
Yep, and we're it's important that the coffee brewed at the beginning is shitty.
Yes.
It's an important detail that if you're not paying attention.
Yeah, if you're not paying attention, you miss it.
You know, like, there's a whole lot of stuff in the big... I can imagine someone who is not as big of a Tarantino fan as us watching the first half of the movie and be like, oh, it's all this fucking, it's so boring. But because we love Tarantino, we love his dialogue, we love the characters and the way they interact and their back and forth and their power dynamics, we're fucking engaged, and so we're paying attention to every word.
Yeah.
And everything being shown on screen, and there are so many small details that would be easy to miss if you're not paying attention.
And having Samuel Jackson deliver most of the expository dialogue was a really good choice.
Him and Kurt Russell, like, you cannot look away from the screen when they're up there.
Yeah.
Which is they use to their advantage sometimes when, like, you're supposed to be when something is happening, but Kurt Russell's on screen, so you're kind of missing it in the background, but, like...
Yeah, and actually doing the thing where, like, they hold tight on, like, Sam Jackson's face as he's giving the exposition, so it's not him talking to another character, it's him talking to the audience.
Yeah.
You know, because he looks right in the camera, and of course he's got Sam Jackson face, so it's amazing.
I fucking love the, like Alfred Hitchcock Presents...
Oh my god, yeah, we come back from the intermission,
like,
and
Tarantino
the narration
has this voiceover where he's talking about, okay, here's what just happened, but here's what you missed. And
yeah.
And it reminded me of Hitchcock. Like,
yeah.
You know, something Hitchcock would do, and I kind of really love that. I'm sure there's someone out there that probably thinks it's like, oh, it's egotistical or whatever. Fuck that. That was awesome. I love that. That to me felt Hitchcock. So
yeah. It was like it was a bit of the showmanship. It was it cocky. Yeah, it was cocky.
Well, Tarantino
is totally cocky.
Tarantino is cocky, but I never minded that Tarantino is cocky because he always backs it up.
Yeah, as evidenced in the second half of this movie.
Yeah.
Where shit goes down.
Yeah.
So basically, right after Sam Jackson has fucking, like, killed this guy.
And there are characters we haven't even brought up yet.
Yes.
There's fucking Michael Madsen's cowboy character, who's very mysterious and is just quiet in the background. Like, what's his deal?
Yeah. You know? There's a Mexican guy who meets them.
Yes, Bob. Who actually is played by a Hispanic man. Throughout the movie, I was trying to figure out if it was, like, because he has this very thick beard, if it was actually someone pretending to be Hispanic.
Yeah. Like you take the thing off and it's like Christoph Waltz or something.
Yeah.
I was wondering that too.
Because I was like, oh man, like he kind of looks like for a second, for there was a while there where I'm like, with that beard, he kind of looks like Robert De Niro, but he's not listening to the crowd.
Like, yeah. But you're like, well, he's fucking.
No, it's actually the guy who played Che in Soderbergh's Che Rivera movie.
Oh.
So it actually is a Hispanic guy. And it turns out in the movie, he's supposed to be like Hispanic. But because you're watching the movie and paying attention and trying to figure out, okay, what hints are there that people are lying?
You know?
And there's a lot of them. Like there's a point where like I remember a character saying something that he said someone else said, but I don't remember the other character saying it. And then you realize that they already knew going in.
Yeah, they knew going in who
they're dealing with. So no one actually said it. He just knew, which was a clue that he was not who he said he was. Like it's so well written like that.
Yeah, really good.
You know?
God, when fucking the thing I loved was finding out that the whole cocksucking scene itself was a setup.
Yeah.
It was a narrative setup.
Yep. Oh, a narrative setup for one of the most brilliant comeuppances.
Yeah.
Because
fucking what happens is Sam Jackson starts, shoots this one guy and starts figuring out that something is going, that he's suspicious, but now he like knows shit is going down.
And when he's piecing together a bunch of the stuff that as an audience member, if you've been paying attention, you're trying to piece together too.
Yeah.
You know.
But so basically, there is a poisoning scene that happens. Yeah. A couple people get
killed.
And it's
brilliant because all the potential suspects all had the black glove that you see when the poisoning thing happens. You know, because I was paying attention to that. I'm like, who has black gloves? I'm like, oh man, these guys all have black gloves, which are all the people that Sam Jackson, puts up against the wall.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, God. And then there's a flashback to what happened like earlier that day and how all these people that they meet
at this
shop in the middle of nowhere got there.
I love that sequence I fucking love that sequence because this entire time, the actual owner of the place that they're at is supposedly, according to the Hispanic, housekeeper, is off meeting their mother for Christmas or something like that.
Yeah, and Sam Jackson is instantly suspicious.
Yeah. He's like, I don't think about this. So he's constantly like going back and forth with the Hispanic guy, like trying to test his,
his knowledge of what's going on.
But what I love about this whole thing is like they go over thing like when the final when that final like reveal happens with the Mexican guy, and just like, and she, you know what sign used to be above that thing?
Yeah,
and it's all about how the owner of the thing used to have a sign that said no Mexicans are dogs, but she took it down because she eventually allowed dogs.
And there's this question about like how is Sam Jackson so cozy with these
people? Yeah, and then it goes to the
flashback, and you realize
that the woman they've been talking about this whole time, who as an audience member I assumed was white based on
what they were saying, you do,
is actually a big sassy black woman.
And
you realize,
oh,
why does Sam Jackson know her? I got the feeling that Sam Jackson was cozy with her.
I got
this very strong feeling that Sam Jackson and her had something going on, which is why he fucking brutalizes the Hispanic guy.
Yeah.
That was probably one of the most brutal fucking...
Oh, man. That was
execution so for the beautiful movie.
Oh, man. Oh, God. So, yes, yeah, so he's got all these people against the wall, and... An unusual alliance is formed.
Yes, between Sam Jackson and the son of the Confederate general guy.
The son of the racist sheriff.
Yeah,
ends up on Sam Jackson's side.
You know, and the way
it turns out, he is a lawman.
And the reason why Sam Jackson is able to trust him is because when they're trying to figure out who fucking poisoned the coffee, he knows that obviously this guy didn't because he was about to drink it before the first guy who dies from it dies.
Yeah.
You know, so like
he obviously didn't know.
He didn't know. He would have died if he had done it. So it must have been the other people.
Yeah. So as he's like trying to figure out like which one of them did it or if they're all in it together.
Yeah. Yeah.
at that moment is when they reveal that there aren't eight characters, there are nine.
Yeah.
And from below the floorboards, Channing Tatum blows Sam Jackson's testicles off.
What does he keep calling him after that? Like, fucking, like...
Bushwhacker.
Bushwhacker, yeah.
Yeah. You motherfucking Bushwhacker.
Guys, fucking amazing. God.
I loved that scene. It was so good.
This is neither here nor there, but just, like thinking about the movie, like from, like, a, like a more analytical artist, like, point of view. Like, I like how the movie... Like inside this cabin is like a microcosm of America.
Yes,
you know you have the black guy, you have the Hispanic guy, and then you have like the war soldiers, and you have like the sheriff, you have the law, and you have all these things, and then you have the poor woman caught in the middle of all this, who could be innocent, could not be, who knows?
Spoilers: she's not.
She's not. She's yeah, not. She's much. Not. No one in this movie is fucking innocent. So.
Just, yeah, Obi is the closest.
Oh, he probably is. He might
he's
be.
He's probably innocent because he's just the stagecoach driver.
Yeah, he's you know, probably the most.
But innocent. our people, cast of people, scoundrels.
Some of the people like in the flashback were probably innocent.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like Minnie's like, reasonably like, innocent.
Yeah, Zoe Bell's
the stagecoach driver.
Yeah, yeah. Was it like Jenny?
Six Horse is yeah, Six Horse Jenny.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. She seemed pretty innocent, and she's probably the one that you're like. Your heart like kind of breaks when yeah. he dies, because you know, like, oh man, she really liked him. Like,
yeah, yeah, yeah. just like just innocent people.
Yeah,
you know.
And Minnie's relatively innocent aside from her complete racism
against Mexican yes. people,
which is racism. I don't care what you fucking say.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that fucking that comes up in that flashback too, which is why I was like, God damn it! Like,
yeah,
it was really funny.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Jesus Christ, like, this movie, like, if we go any further, we're gonna ruin the whole movie for you.
So. Yeah, yeah, I just, god damn it.
Like, pay attention to everything.
I'm keeping this.
Fuck yeah, I got one too over there. That was a cinematic experience.
It was.
If you fucking downloaded this movie and then reviewed it after watching the screener, fuck you.
Oh no.
Watch the movie for real.
No, you
guys. Which is on the big screen.
Yeah.
Even if it's not the 70 millimeter one, which if you can do that,
yeah, if you can't do that, because like I'm like, no, that's the cut of the movie.
Oh my god,
that's the movie right there.
That
I don't
fucking
know
beautiful
how you can...
little shake of the projector actually did add a little.
Oh,
of
it did, it
movie.
Did.
Yeah,
I can't imagine what they could have cut. Except for maybe the whole flashback sequence?
I'm guessing.
But that adds so much to the film, it'd be a shame.
My guess, I don't know exactly what's cut in the shorter version.
Yeah, yeah.
My guess
no
would probably
clue.
Be probably some of those like long vistas of them like traveling from one location to another were probably cut.
Yeah, down. Yeah.
They're pretty long, but I love them because they looked so beautiful and it kind of showed the passage of how long it takes to get to these locations back then. So it worked. But I'm guessing for the shorter cut, in order to make it more streamlined, and plus those ones are, like, those shots so, like, clearly show how beautiful, like, 70mm
yeah.
framing is, I'm guessing those are the ones they cut, but I don't know for sure.
Yeah, my only regret is that, we saw this at the Kabuki Sundance, my only regret is that they didn't have it on the big two-level
oh, that would have been
screen.
Awesome.
I think they had awesome. Star Wars playing on that
one. We almost had a fucking, like, in order to talk about our experience seeing the movie, we almost had a scare there because...
Oh, God, yeah.
We got there and a guy comes out that was cleaning the it's like, oh, they're having a problem with the projector. We might show the digital projection. And we're like, what?
Yeah.
We came there to see the extended 70mm cut. You mean you're going to show us... After all that and all that paying extra, like, what are we...
Yeah, yeah. We, like, considering, like, getting our money back. But yeah. They're like, no, fuck, we'll just watch it anyway.
Well, because that was the only place... I think that's the only place in town showing that.
It is, version. It is.
So, like, if we're not going to see it there, then we're not going to see it at all, so we might as well see the other version. Like,
yeah.
You know, but they must have fixed it because it starts off, the interlude starts, and we get halfway through the movie, the intermission happens, and we're like, okay this is...
Yeah.
You know, and it is...
Oh, man.
It's
such a good movie. Yeah, no, seriously, go watch it for real.
Absolutely. Let me put it this way. I am revising my top 10 list that I had already written and recorded and had started editing. I am revising it to bump something off the list to put The Hateful Eight in.
Definitely. Definitely. Definitely.
Like, it's got to go in, so... Yeah. See the fucking Hateful Eight. It is a fucking masterpiece.